I am, Mr. Tarrou. Okay, we are going to be looking at evaluating algebraic expressions. And evaluating means that when we get done, we're going to have just a singular or single numerical value, generally. And we're going to use the values of square root of 5 for w, negative 3 for x, 2 for y, and 4 for z. And we're going to run through 6 examples. And through all of these examples, since we're giving these numerical values to plug into the expressions, we're going to be careful of parentheses to make sure our signs end up being correct when we're done. And we're going to remember the order of operations, which you might have a phrase that you help or use to help you remember that order of operations. My phrase that I know is, please excuse my dear Aunt Sally. And the first letter is what these operations are. Please for parentheses, excuse for exponents, my dear for multiplication and division, Aunt Sally for addition and subtraction. Now, when you look at an algebraic expression, you are supposed to simplify what's inside the parentheses first, if possible, and these are all going to be numerical values, so we will. Then deal with your exponents, and then work on your multiplication and division. And you do multiplication and division, and actually, you know, as you look at this expression, you read them like a book. You read them like, you know, left to right. Now, I can't say two words at one time, so it just comes out multiply and then divide, but they're on the same sort of like level playing field. We don't really multiply before we divide, or vice versa. We read these expressions left to right, and as, you know, whatever math function we come up to first, take care of that. So if multiplication shows up first, then multiply first. If division shows up first, then you're going to divide first. Like 10 divided by 2 times, let's say, 3. Well, if you were stuck in your mind that you have to multiply before you divide, you might think that you're going to do 2 times 3, which is 6, and think, well, then it's going to be 10 divided by 6, which is 10 sixths, or that would be 5 thirds. Well, that is not correct. None of this is. You are going to look at multiplication and division and read that expression left to right and do whatever comes first. Well, so as I read this left to right, I have 10 divided by 2, which is equal to 5. And then I bring down the multiplication of 3, and of course 5 times 3 is equal to 15. So multiplication and division, you don't multiply first. You go left and right through the expression and you do whatever math operation you see first as far as that pairing goes along. Same thing with addition and subtraction. We don't necessarily add before we subtract. Those are on the same sort of like level playing field. You read through the expression left to right and you do whatever of these two you see first. Now, of course, ultimately it's parentheses first, then it's exponents, then it's multiplication to get division together, whatever comes first, and addition and subtraction. So, keeping that in mind, let's do our first example. Actually, it's our second now, right? We have 3x squared plus y minus 7. Okay, so that's our expression. We're going to come to our list of numerical values that we're asked to plug into it, and we're going to have 3 parentheses x squared, so that's going to be 3 parentheses negative 3 squared plus y, which is equal to 2 minus 7. And I'm going to do these math operations one step at a time and rewrite the whole new line. Because the more I see students, especially in the beginnings of algebra, shortcut their work, the more likely they are to make careless mistakes and have a general understanding of what they're doing, but consistently get the wrong answers. So, parentheses, there's nothing to do inside here and nothing to do inside here. So then we go into exponents. Negative 3 squared is 3 times negative 3 times negative 3. There is no reason for you to do this in your scratch work. I'm just teaching you negative 3 squared is negative 3 times negative 3. And we get 9. And I don't need this parentheses around the 2 because it's just a plus sign up front, so I've dropped it. And we've got plus 2 minus 7. 3 times 9, keeping up with the order of operations, multiplication next. So 3 times 9 is 27. Plus 2 minus 7, kind of a funny looking 7 there. So we have now, what do we got? We got 27 plus 2 is 29. minus 7, which ultimately comes out to be 22. Now, your teacher, I'm sure, is going to be asking you to show some work. You may not have to show, you know, this much, but, you know, at least show a few lines to let the teacher know that you're actually doing the order of operations. You're not just typing these values into your two-line scientific calculator or your graphing calculator that does the order of operations for you, and come down to an answer of 22. You might be noticing that not only am I doing one step at a time, but I'm using parentheses when I substitute in these numerical values, and here's the reason why. There is a difference, just as an example, of you just saw me write negative 3 squared. Well, there's a difference between negative 3 squared and negative 3 squared. These expressions are not equal to each other. Negative 3 squared is negative 3 times negative 3, as you just saw me write, which comes out to be 9. Well, over here where it's negative 3 squared, exponents only act on what they're touching or sitting upon. So when it's negative 3 squared without the parentheses, the only thing being squared is the 3. This is actually can be rewritten as negative 1 times 3 squared. When you have a negative sign, that acts, that can be written as a multiplication of negative 1. And again, it's only the 3 being squared, so you have negative 1 times, now, 3 squared is 3 times 3, and that comes out to be negative 9. Depending on the type of calculator that you're using, this difference may have been hidden for quite a while. So you do need to be aware that these parentheses do serve a point, and you could not understand that for quite a while, and depending on whether you're always doing these this math operations in your head, or maybe just a older style scientific calculator with one line, this difference might have been hidden. But as soon as you start using those two-line scientifics or graphing calculators that really pay attention to your syntax, that's how you type these expressions and these values into your calculator, you will start noticing, if you don't understand that this is, you know, this relationship here, that this difference, you will start getting some incorrect answers and not maybe realize why. All right, as our next example, these are going to increase in difficulty as we go. We have yz minus x squared. Okay, so we've got y, which is 2, z, which is 4, and if I write it like that, it looks like 24. If I write it like that, it shows 2 times 4, but if you're in a hurry and you miss that little dot, it can still be kind of, you know, misconstrued as 24 as you're maybe doing a test and you're nervous. So make sure that you use parentheses around everything you plug in. That's another reason why I like them. Minus x, which is negative 3. Here is another good reason for using parentheses when you do substitution. My expression already has a negative sign, and I'm plugging in a number that has its own negative sign. A lot of students will forget that, you know, that there's a negative already there, I'm plugging in the number that is negative, and they forget one of them and end up, you know, having a sign error in their problem. So make sure, again, everywhere you're going to plug in a number, put those parentheses there even before you plug in the numbers. Actually, this is a good idea. You go, okay, y, z, minus, x, squared. Like, don't even think about the numbers that you're plugging in. Just write out the pattern and put a set of parentheses everywhere there's a variable. And then go in and plug in the numbers. Y, again, is 2. Z is 4. And then with the negative already there and the negative number that you're plugging in, there won't be any question about, did I already put that negative sign there or is there another one coming in? Okay, anyway, we have parentheses. We have a lot of stuff in those parentheses, so we're going to simplify. 2 and 4 is 8. A negative times a negative, or when two negatives are together, and it is multiplication, it is effectively negative 1 times negative 3, that's positive 3, squared, and 8 plus 3 is 11, and that squared is 121. So there you go. Okay. Our next example. We have y squared over x plus z minus x squared over y minus x. So you can see that we're stepping up in difficulty here. Y squared, so 2, over x, which is negative 3, plus z, which is 4. Some of these parentheses I'm putting in aren't really going to do anything, it's just out of habit. X is negative 3 over y, which is 2, minus x, which is negative 3 again. Let's work this out and see what happens. 2 squared is equal to 4. I'm going to do a couple things at once here. Fraction bars act as a grouping symbol. It's kind of like, actually not kind of like, it is a grouping symbol. It does act as a parentheses in the sense that you need to get the top and the bottom simplified to a single number, or simplified as much as possible before you actually try and do the division. So negative 3 plus 4 is negative 1, excuse me, positive 1, minus negative 3 squared, that's going to be negative 3 times negative 3, because it's in parentheses, so that's going to be 9, over negative and a negative. That's going to make a positive, so we're going to have 2 plus 3, because of these negatives coming together and making a positive value. So we have 4 over 1 minus 9 over 5. So I have some fractions left I have to deal with. Well, let's not forget, you cannot subtract fractions unless you have a common denominator. So 4 minus 9, or yeah, 4 over 1 minus 9 over 5 is not, you know, I'm not going to subtract the tops and the bottoms. I'm going to make common denominators first. So I'm looking for the lowest common multiple between 1 and 5. What's the smallest number that 1 and 5 can both go into? Well, that's going to be 5. So I'm going to multiply top and bottom by 5. This is going to become 5 times 4, which is 20, over 5, because it's 5 times 1, minus 9 over 5. Now that I have my common denominators I got by multiplying the top and the bottom of the fraction by the same value, which is effectively 1, 5 divided by 5 is 1, so I'm just making this fraction look different, I'm not changing its value. Once I have my common denominator, I'll just subtract the tops and I'm done. 20 minus 9 is 11 over 5. Now, that is done, and it is an improper fraction, but if your teacher's been teaching you mixed fractions, where they do not want the top number to be larger than the bottom number, the numerator to be larger than the denominator, then you're going to need to turn 11 over 5 into a mixed fraction. Well, you do that by division. You know, how many 5s are there in 11? What is 11 divided by 5? Well, on a calculator, that's 2.2, but I don't want decimals. How many 5s are in 11? 5, 10. So, that's 2. What's the remainder? 5 times 2 is 10. The numerator was 11. So if I take out the 10 from 11, that gives me a remainder of 1. So use whatever format of your fraction that your teacher wants, improper or mixed, and you'll be good. Two more examples, and we'll call it a day for this video. Hopefully you're finding it helpful. Evaluating expressions, we've got w squared minus 3x. So that's going to be something squared minus 3 times something. Well, w is square root of 5. And the x is equal to negative 3. And we've got to work this out. Well, parentheses. Nothing to do in there, nothing to do in there. Exponents. Square root of 5 squared. Well, this is the square root of 5 times the square root of 5. And the square root of 5 times square root of 5, you can multiply those together. The square root of 5 times the square root of 5, 5 times 5 is 25. And the square root of 25 is 5. Okay, so that's this little piece. Negative 3 times negative 3 is when you multiply two negatives, you get a positive answer. When you multiply two positives, you get a positive answer. But these are both negative. Negative 3 times negative 3 is positive 9. And 5 and 9 is 14. Last example. We have got the absolute value of 3x plus z squared. All right, absolute values. If you don't know what these absolute value symbols are, if you haven't covered those in your math class yet, don't worry about it. But if you have seen them before, what they appear to do is just drop the negative sign. Okay, the absolute value of 7 is 7, because there is no negative sign there. And the absolute value of negative 7 is also equal to 7. Well, what the absolute value symbol does by dropping the negative sign in front of a single numerical value is it tells you how far that point is away from the origin. 7 is 7 units away from the origin, 7 units to the right. Negative 7 is 7 units from the origin as well, or 0. It's 7 units to the left. So it just appears like you're dropping the negative sign if there is one, but the absolute value function tells you how far a number is away from 0. I think I said the origin before, but 0 on the number line. But we cannot apply the absolute value function until the inside is simplified into a single number. They are, after all, they look like parentheses and they do act like parentheses. They are a grouping symbol. It's just at the end, if the number happens to be negative, you're going to drop it and say, well, this is my final answer. So let's see what happens. We have the absolute value of 3 times what x is plus whatever z is squared and close the absolute value sign. X is negative 3 again. Z is 4. Okay, so we have 3 times negative 3 is negative 9. And I'm going to do both two math operations at once. This is multiplication. And I'm also going to, you know, I said you're supposed to do parentheses and then exponents. So really you're supposed to do exponents before you multiply. But I'm going to do both of those steps in the same line here. 4 squared, 4 times 4, not 4 times 2, 4 times 4 is 16. And as a cautionary note here, if I try and apply the absolute value symbol or function right now and make the 9 positive, I am going to get a wrong answer to you. Do not apply the absolute value function until the inside is cleaned up or simplified or evaluated into a single value. So we've got negative 9 plus 16. When your numbers have different signs, you're going to subtract those numbers and keep the sign of the largest number. The absolute value of 16 is bigger than the absolute value of 9. So 16 minus 9 is 7. And the absolute value of 7, oh, I didn't do that on purpose, ends up actually being 7. And there's our answer. Well, I'm Mr. Drew. Bam! Go do your homework. Thank you for watching. I hope this has helped.